Good evening, everyone. I'm Melanie Carter, Associate Provost and Director of the Center for HBCU Research, Leadership, and Policy here at Howard University. Welcome to our Black College Conversations lecture series. Through this program and others, the HBCU Center seeks to identify issues, examine practices, and disseminate research that will enrich not only the field of higher education, but also our institutions, our communities, our nation, and our world. The Center for HBCU Research, Leadership, and Policy, also known as the HBCU Center, was established in June 2021 by President Wayne Frederick, who remains convinced that Howard University is an ideal site for a center focused on HBCUs, not as a phenomenon to be acontextually studied and dissected, but as an ecosystem which has influenced every aspect of this nation, its institutions, its politics, its economic systems, and its social realities, challenges, and aspirations. The HBCU Center seeks to fulfill its mission to bring together researchers and practitioners to support a thriving HBCU ecosystem by producing empirical research, studies, and offering programs and resources that leverage the collective strength of HBCUs. We also seek to identify best practices in higher education that build upon the achievements and cultural-driven practices of HBCUs to ensure their 22nd century success. And thirdly, we seek to embrace those who embrace institutional collaboration as a core strategy. Today's session focuses on the recently published book, Vital and Valuable: The Relevance of HBCUs to American Life and Education, by James Cook and Amari Swinton. Both economists, Dr. Cook and Swinton's in-depth and critical analysis of large-scale data offers empirical insight that illuminates the critical need and role and impact of HBCUs. This evening, we will first hear from the authors. Dr. James Cook is the Board of Visitors Professor of Economics Emeritus and President Emeritus of Old Dominion University. His recent books include Runaway College Cost, How College Governing Boards Fail to Protect Their Students, and The Impoverishment of the American College Student. Dr. Amari Swinton is Chair, Director of Graduate Studies, and Professor in the Department of Economics at Howard University. He is a past president of the National Economics Association. Our moderator, Dr. Ivory Tolson, is Professor of Counseling Psychology in the School of Education at Howard University and also Editor-in-Chief of the Journal of Negro Education. He is also the National Director of Education, Innovation, and Research for the NAACP. A former Executive Director of the White House Initiative on HBCUs, Dr. Tolson is a recognized scholar whose book, which is one of my favorites, No BS, Bad Stats, Black People Need People Who Believe in Black People Enough Not to Believe Every Bad Thing They Hear About Black People. I love that title. And it challenges mainstream perceptions and myths about African Americans. So following the author's presentation, Dr. Tolson will lead our discussion, followed by an opportunity for questions from the audience. Dr. Swinton and Dr. Cook.
So, good afternoon. I think this is the first time I've actually given a presentation at Howard since I got hired here 12 years. Well, I've been here a long time, but since 2007. So, it's not often that I get to share my research with the Howard community, and this is something that I greatly appreciate the opportunity and being the first book that I've ever published and being able to present it at Howard to start off is something that's very special for me. So the title of my book, as Provost Carter said, is Vital and Valuable: The Relevance of HBCUs to American Life and Education, and this is with my co-author, James Cook. Our book focuses on 102 of the four-year historically black colleges and universities in the United States. Cheney University, which is the first HBCU, was founded in 1837, and most HBCU were founded after the Civil War. But it wasn't until 1865 that in the Higher Education Act that the U.S. government formally recognized HBCUs as a group. So there will never be any new HBCUs ever in the U.S. except the ones that were recognized in 1865. So every time an HBCU that exists no longer exists, there's just one less of these universities that exist as a whole. So the first publicly supported HBCU, which is known as University of District of Columbia, was founded in 1851 as the Minor Normal School. Taxpayers supported the HBCU, received impetus for the passage of the Second Morrell Act, which helped establish racially segregated land grant institutions for black individuals, which excluded existing land grant institutions. And so in the South, a lot of these institutions were founded, such as Delaware State, Fort Valley State, North Carolina A&T, South Carolina State, and West Virginia State. Howard University represents a special case for HBCUs. Even though it's a private institution, it's federally chartered. It's one of two schools that actually has a line item in the federal budget, that along with Gallaudet University, which puts Howard in a unique situation. It's also the only comprehensive HBCU, which has law school, medical school, dental school. Every type of school is represented at Howard University. So our book looks specifically at an analytical view of HBCUs, and we use the techniques that are designed from economics, so regression analysis with a very large data set. It builds on previous work that was done with co-author Bill Spriggs, who is also a Howard professor, and that looks at sort of the returns to earnings for blacks attending HBCUs, and other work by Price and Sheffield in the Journal of Negro Education, which is the journal that Ivory is the editor for, and other articles from the Journal of Black Studies and the Atlantic Economic Journal. There's not as much empirical research done on HBCUs as a lot of people would like. It's not a subject that is studied as rigorously as it needs to be, because oftentimes in research as a whole, just for the black community as a whole, there's not as much data available, and the data isn't as good as it is for other groups, so people don't do the research. And to be honest, a lot of researchers don't necessarily care about blacks in general when they do research, and so questions about these types of organizations are often ignored. So this book is going to try to fill this gap where most of the stuff is the stuff on HBCUs is descriptive and normative, but we're going to put an analytical analysis, and all the data and facts that we have are backed up by the data, backed up by regression analysis, and when Jim comes up, you're going to see some of our major findings with some of the graphs. We're economists, we like graphs, we like regressions, so you'll see some of that in when he comes up. But we think this is the first book to really rigorously use statistical measures to undertake a big picture analysis of the large sample of HBCUs and analyze that outside of graduation rates, but also look at admission applications and admission yields, upward economic mobility, expenditures on instruction versus administration, expenditures on intercollegiate athletics, the net prices charged by HBCUs compared to the competition, HBCUs and the challenge of distance learning, the increasing competition that HBCUs have with non-HBCUs for black students, and private gifts and endowment. So Jim is going to come up and finish the presentation.
Well, first of all, let me say it's a pleasure and a privilege to be here at Howard, but especially so to spend a little time with Amari, who's a great colleague and a very excellent economist. This is really the second time we've met face-to-face. We may have done 50 Zooms and all kinds of telephone calls, but this is the first time the second time really that we've met. Let's talk about some of the positive things that one can say about HBCUs. There's this issue of access, and I put these numbers up here, we put these numbers up here because, yes, blacks can be admitted to these institutions, but they are not admitting very many black individuals to these institutions. So some of the story that one hears, some of the narrative that one hears about, well, this is open, that's open, if you look at these numbers, you can see that's not very open and not as wide open as we think there should be, which means that HBCUs oftentimes have to carry the ball down the field. HBCUs, I think many of you know, really excel at providing upward economic mobility. Let's suppose we concentrate on the students who come from households who are ranked in the bottom 20% of the income distribution, the bottom quintile. Let's concentrate on them and then say, how many of those students, after they graduate, come up into the top fourth or fifth quintile? Well, you can see the numbers here. It's pretty impressive. If we're talking about Morris Harvey, for example, if you look at those students who came in the bottom 20%, and lots of them at Morris Harvey do, 53% of them are in the top 40% 14 or 15 years later. Now, if one compares the performance of HBCUs in this particular arena with other institutions, HBCUs do better. Look at these classifications that we have. We're looking at public flagship institutions, private institutions, large public urban institutions, public regional campuses. HBCUs do better at raising up students in terms of economic mobility than any of those groups of institutions. It's a pretty impressive performance. Graduation rates. This is a little bit of a sort of a thought experiment for you, and economists run regressions. And so what we do is we have something we call the dependent variable, and we're going to then say, how can we explain the performance of that based upon other things? And here the dependent variable is the graduation rate. If the only thing you knew about an institution is the type of institution it is, whether it's, for example, an HBCU, a regional, a flagship, or whatever, you would say, gee, the data say that the graduation rates will be 22% lower at HBCUs. But now let's add an additional variable to the analysis, and that'll be HBCUs plus SAT scores. Once you control for SAT scores, you can see that actually HBCUs are performing 3.68% better than all the rest of the institutions. And if you add household income, HBCUs are performing 9.93% better. So if we look at what I would call an even playing field, and we're saying, let's take into account income levels and SAT scores, HBCUs are really performing at a very high level. Indeed, they are performing better than all those other classes of institutions. Whoops, I went the wrong direction here. And sorry about that, I messed that up. But let me recover here. Okay, that's the one I was on. Let's do this one. We have somewhat the same story if we're talking about mid-career incomes. Mid-career income, we're talking about somebody who's 35 or 40 years old, and we're saying, what's the income they earn? Well, if the only thing you know about them is they came from an HBCU, you'd say, well, they're not earning as much. But once you control for SAT scores, and here I'm using Pell Grants as a proxy for household income, then HBCU students are actually performing better than the same student with the same qualifications would have done at the non-HBCU institution. So HBCUs are doing better in that arena as well. Now the pipeline performance of HBCUs, I think you know well, and you recognize these names, and we could write down lots of other names. But if you look at that bottom paragraph, what that's saying is the professional black groups of individuals who are serving people every day around the country, they owe a tremendous debt to HBCUs because it's HBCUs that are really producing the great majority of these individuals. And maybe that will change in the future, but it's certainly not the case right now. And I did that again, and I'm sorry, I'm a little bit incompetent here on this particular machine. So let's go then to this one, and I'll try to not stumble again. Another thing that HBCUs are very important is that they, in many small southern communities, are the industry. And I'll give you one specific example, Mississippi Valley State University, which is in Itabena, Mississippi. If it weren't there, that town would virtually disappear. It is a very important economic enterprise there. It's a social enterprise. It brings people in from around the county. It provides jobs. That's something that sometimes gets ignored, that these institutions are really a core part of their communities. Now, there are some concerns that we uncovered, or at least challenges might be a better way to say it. First of all, HBCUs are not necessarily the low-cost alternative. Many people think they are, but it turns out that that's not so, and I'm going to show you some data in a moment. Some HBCUs have fairly high administrative costs. Now, if you think about this, and the measure that one gets from the federal government here is something called instructional or institutional support, and that's sort of an administrative measure. HBCUs don't tend to look very good that way. Their costs per full-time equivalent student are fairly high, but there is at least one reason for that, and that is that a lot of HBCUs are fairly small, and so they are not able to realize economies of scale. If they were larger, they could spread the cost of software and things like that over more students, and their costs per unit would fall. So that's something to keep in mind when you look at the data I'm going to show you. Number three, HBCUs are experiencing now much greater competition from PWIs, from non-HBCUs, than ever has been the case in before. Maybe they weren't interested so much in the past, but many of them are more interested now. Fourth, there's a demographic cliff that's going to affect all of higher education. There are simply going to be fewer high school graduates out there, and that's going to affect HBCUs and everybody else, but maybe in certain states like Mississippi, where there are a lot of HBCUs, it's particularly a problem. And then fifth, something I want to talk a little bit more about, but briefly, is that HBCUs oftentimes aren't terribly prepared to do quality distance learning. And again, that relates to the size of the institution sometimes. They simply don't have the resources to do that. Now, talking about prices, if you look at the far left there, this might surprise you. Here we're talking about students who come to a campus from a family that has an income between $0 and $30,000. Net price, the price that students pay after scholarships and grants have been deducted, the net price at non-HBCUs is actually lower than it is at HBCUs. And I'm giving you then two examples to the right where the white institution is underpricing the HBCU. Many people don't realize this is the case, but it is a competitive problem for HBCUs because here's the University of South Carolina that's $7,000 less expensive. Amari and I have talked about this, and we think this is somewhat of a policy problem, a social problem. We're not even sure that people in South Carolina understand that that's true, and maybe it shouldn't be true. Let's talk about administrative costs. Now, in the red there, you can see that HBCUs, as a percentage of their total expenditures, are spending more on administration than most other kinds of institutions. Again, economies of scale have something to do with that, but it may also be true that HBCUs tend to be a little bit more administratively top-heavy than other institutions. That's a challenge to confront in the future because these are dollars that are not being spent on instruction and research and public service. Competition from other institutions. I'm at Old Dominion University. Old Dominion University has about 30 or 35% black students. but I think you would classify it as a PWI, even though that particular definition maybe is a little bit outdated. But if you look at this particular graph, the yellow there is the percentage of black students, undergraduate students at Old Dominion. And the bars are the enrollment of Norfolk State University, an HBCU that's 4 or 5 miles away. You don't have to be Albert Einstein to see what's going on here. Old Dominion appears to be taking black students away from Norfolk State. Now, this is a scenario which appears to be true in a number of other cases where there is a large urban institution performing near to an HBCU. And this is a competition that could turn out to be fairly ruthless, actually, as the number of high school graduates begins to decline. Speaking of that decline, here's the data. Now, these are national data that relate to the total number of high school graduates, but you can see that it tops out in 2027 and begins to decline. And it's going to decline for 10 or 12 years thereafter, at least. So there aren't going to be as many bodies out there. Now put this in the context, please, of higher education headcount enrollment having already gone down 11 years in a row nationally. So already higher education enrollment is going down, and now we're going to add this to it, and that is going to be a world in which some small private HBCUs are going to find it very difficult to survive. So that's a definite challenge that is out there on the horizon. Distance learning, I mentioned this before, but many HBCUs aren't particularly well situated to do distance learning, and this is occurring at a time when distance learning is going up as a percentage of students. But that middle paragraph is instructive. Many people don't even know that Southern New Hampshire University exists, but it has 121,000 students. And according to the US DOE, 13% are black. Well, that's 15,000. And if 9% of all black students go to HBCUs on average, that suggests that approximately 1,426 students have been claimed by Southern New Hampshire that might have in the past gone to an HBCU. Now, there are lots of other distance learning institutions out there that are huge, like Grand Canyon and so forth. And that, again, is a real challenge because, again, many HBCUs are not well situated to do distance learning. These are the declines in high school graduates in some states that have lots of HBCUs. There are some states where the number of high school grads is going up, and I list those. But you can see in Mississippi, for example, 19%. That I just mentioned Mississippi Valley State University. That's got to be a problem for them, or for Jackson State, et cetera. Now, we don't, in our book, claim that we're solving all the problems or certainly addressing all the issues. What we do think is that if you take time to read the book, you'll see some pretty careful empirical work. Not so much opinions, but rather data, saying this is what the data tell us, and some of the things that I've showed you, we've showed you today, may have come as a bit of a surprise to you, but that's one of the functions of the book, we hope, is to alert people to things that are going on and to sensitize people to the issues. And with that, I think we will accept questions or comments or whatever. Thank you.
Next, we have a panel moderated by Dr. Tolson, and we'll ask our panelists to come up and also the authors.
All right, good evening.
Good evening.
That's some powerful data, right? All right, so the first thing I want to do is introduce the panel. Well, I guess the first thing I want to do is to really commend the authors for your work. You know, when I looked at that presentation, yeah, the excellence and the story of HBCUs really came out. And I when I reflected on the title, I thought about the experience I had with President Norm Francis from Xavier. And this was his last year as president of Xavier, and he was doing his goodbye tour. So I saw him at the home of Mary Landrieu on Capitol Hill. And he said that when he was first appointed president of Xavier University in Louisiana in 1968, now this is the same year that Martin Luther King was assassinated, he said that before he took the position, someone told him, or someone asked him, said, why are you going to be president of an HBCU? Do you think they're still relevant? Now this is 1968, and somebody was already trying to force us into a post-racial society while cities were literally being burned down because of what was happening to black students. So defending the relevance of HBCUs, unfortunately, has been a longstanding part of our history. But this book really takes this to another level because as Dr. Swinton said, a lot of times we don't defend our relevance with data. You know, we'll defend it with anecdote. But to have this powerful display of data and to let the data tell the story for us is something that I think is very revolutionary. So I really thank you all sincerely for the work and look forward to hearing more about it. We also have a panel that has a broad array of experience, and I have the benefit of knowing everyone on the panel personally. First one is someone who is on faculty with me in the School of Education, Dr. Robert Palmer, who is right here at Howard University, and he leads our education leadership program, which is specifically focused on HBCUs, maybe one of the only one, or the only two or three in this nation. But Dr. Palmer is definitely a thought leader. You can see his commentary on some major publications like Diverse Issues, and is a tireless champion for HBCUs. We also have someone who is a student of mine, future Dr. Denise Smith, who is at the Century Foundation. And being someone who is able to review her documents, review her dissertation as it formulates, I can attest that she is right on that path to being one of our national experts on HBCU. So glad we can see you now before your price goes up too high. And finally, we have someone who I've worked with for a very long time, Dr. Natasha McClendon, who is at the UNCF Frederick D. Patterson Research Institute. Dr. McClendon and I have worked on lots of projects together, currently working on a few contracts together. And we talk frequently about data for equity. So I know being at the Patterson Institute, an institute that really harnesses data, does a lot of what we saw in the book, harnesses data to tell the right story. The correct story about HBCUs is something that's very powerful. So very happy that you made the trip from Atlanta to be with us. So the first thing I want to do is just to have all of the panelists to fill in the gaps on your bio, let us know a little bit more about your work, but specifically with respect to this book, how do you see using this information in the work that you're doing? Why don't we start with Dr. Palmer?
Yes, well, I'm not sure if this is working. I think my voice is loud enough. I'm happy
to be for the people who are virtual.
Okay, I'm not sure how to work this. Okay. Well, first of all, I'm happy to be here. And as Dr. Tolson mentioned, I've done a lot of work on HBCUs. Really looking at the experiences of black students, and now I'm kind of moving into non-black students. And I've done work on racial and ethnic minorities in STEM within the context of HBCUs, and done work on MSIs, which of course include, of course, and when I say MSIs, I'm talking about minority serving institutions, which of course includes HBCUs, PBIs, which are not the same as HBCUs, and APZs. Tribal colleges and ANAPZs. So So I find this book really informative and really interesting. I'm really kind of happy to see the use of large-scale data to inform our understanding of HBCUs, because really much of what we know about HBCUs is really kind of, you know, rooted in qualitative data. And I think qualitative data has its purpose. I'm a qualitative researcher. But really, I think to kind of see large-scale data, I really think is important to really kind of help challenge some of the myths about HBCUs and to really kind of celebrate the way in which these institutions are important. You know, every now and then, you know, I'm a big fan of social media, and I go on Facebook, and there are conversations about, you know, are HBCUs relevant? You know, and shockingly and surprisingly and unfortunately, these conversations are held among Black folks, you know, who actually think they can get a better education at a predominantly white institution, you know. So I think this book and using a large scale data set really provides that context in terms of the way in which these institutions are relevant and are very beneficial to promoting student access and success, particularly among Black students. Now, with that being said, I do have some things I wanted to point out. I'm not sure if now is the appropriate time to
go ahead.
One of the things I do take issue with, you know, is this notion that, you know, all Black students feel comfortable, or HBCUs do a great job of providing a supportive environment for Black students. You know, I think that may be true to some extent, but that's not true as a whole. You know, for example, there are some students who are LGBTQ, for example, some Black students who are LGBTQ, who may feel more comfortable at a predominantly white institution versus an HBCU because of the conservative climate. So I think we have to be careful when we make kind of blanket statements, really talking about, you know, all Black students feel comfortable at HBCUs, number one. And then number two, we have to have the conversation in terms of what's gonna happen to that support aspect as we have more HBCUs who are kind of running after a Research One status. You know, we know at Research One institutions, the focus really is on research, you know, and kind of less on, not to say that student support and, you know, and engaging students is not important, but really the focus is on research. And so what will happen to that culture of supporting students as we see more and more HBCUs kind of chasing that R1 status? I think that's kind of worthy of a critical conversation, because we see more HBCUs hit it in that direction.
Yeah, thank you. You definitely said some things I want to come back to. But let's jump to Dr. McClendon. In the work that you do at UNCF, how do you see some of this conversation fitting into your analysis and the work that you all are doing there?
So I'd start by saying my educational background, coming from Georgia State for my PhD, I really had a clear perspective on how students are poached from HBCUs. As Georgia State touts themselves as being the number one graduator of Black students, but my dissertation was really around how there's differing definitions of success between those Black students and the institution. So Black students can graduate and not feel successful, because nothing that represents the success to them was achieved through their graduation from that institution. So moving from there to UNCF for the Frederick D. Patterson Research Institute to really drill down into getting empirical data around the anecdotes that we know to be true of experiences that we've seen in our communities of graduates of HBCUs, not only for undergraduate, but graduate degrees, and how they pour into students and create opportunities for them. That's not the same thing happening in a lot of these PWIs that graduate Black students and tout their success, but gave the money and resources for bringing those students in. And so I think at UNCF, what we're really trying to do, similar to what was stated in the book, is really provide empirical evidence to say to people who have money to fund HBCUs, whether it is through federal, state, or private philanthropy, that here is the proof positive that we're making impact in terms of social mobility, in terms of economic impact, in terms of holistic satisfaction by alumni. Not to say that everybody is equally satisfied, but we also share that information and feedback around how we can improve the experience and have open conversation about what we have found with institutions, but from an asset-based perspective. So we never go in with this deficit-based perspective that is something that HBCUs are doing wrong or lesser than other institutions, but just an opportunity to further improve the innovative and successful practices that they've already put forth.
Thank you so much for that. Next, I want to hear from you, future Dr. Smith. From your work at the Century Foundation, how do you see the information that's presented in this book fitting into the work that you do?
So just for context, I always knew I wanted to go to an HBCU. I had siblings that went to South Carolina State University, had cousins that went to FAM and Morehouse and gave me tours in my formative years. And so for me, most of my career has always put me in a position where I was doing work with HBCUs, whether I was working in the West End of Atlanta and working within the AUC to do community-based work or giving grants to HBCUs to address health disparities when it comes to tobacco use. And that work really led me to expand my work to MSIs and community colleges. And so now at the Century Foundation, having that context of understanding what it's like to give grants to institutions, the financial challenges of HBCUs and MSIs, but also what policies could be put in place really led me to be at the Century Foundation to really be able to focus in on what are some of the real policy areas that I could focus on to really help bolster our institutions. And so my first report at the Century Foundation was really focused on the endowment gap and really highlighting how, you know, public HBCUs, their endowments are 3.5 times smaller than their predominantly white institution counterparts. And when you think about the private HBCUs, it is 1/7 of the amount that a predominantly white private institution has. And so through that report, not only do I talk about the endowment gap, but I also highlight moments throughout history when the federal policy has not supported HBCUs, but helped bolster the higher education system in predominantly white institutions to be the system we know it to be today. And so I think identifying ways to identify how to support endowments has been a part of my focus, because there's already vehicles to support that, whether it's through supporting more Title III Part B dollars into our institutions and helping them support that match. We also know in history that, you know, predominantly white institutions received perpetual endowments in land that they were able to sell, right? And so they've had that kind of support. We also know that Native and tribal institutions also receive federal dollars to support their endowments. So there is precedence to help HBCUs bolster their endowments. And so I appreciate the book really talking about the need to have a holistic look at that, because federal policy is one avenue, but we also need private philanthropy to also see the benefits of that. We also need businesses and corporations to see the significance of bolstering HBCU endowments. And then also, I'm currently doing a lot of work around the land-grant institutions, and I was excited to see the data around South Carolina State University, because that's my alma mater. So I'm personally invested in what happens in Orangeburg, because it's important, because I know what that institution did for me, but I also know about how the institution was starved in comparison to USC or Clemson University in South Carolina, right? And so the upcoming reauthorization of the Farm Bill is an opportunity to help bolster these institutions, because they're not only helping to drive research and innovation on their campuses, but these institutions are nourishing the nation with the work that they're doing in extension services. And so between that and also having conversations with people about the race to R1, I think it's important for us to also see that half of those, or nearly about 6 of those land-grant institutions are R2. And so they're doing dynamic research. The problem is that some of these federal agencies don't see the value in the disparities research that they do. So Dr. Palmer, I'm not really concerned because of the fact that these institutions are doing research that is focusing on bettering the Black community.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so Dr. Palmer, you said something that connected to, I think, what Dr. Koch and Dr. Swinton were saying about how the notion of PWI is starting to, I guess, starting to get kind of fuzzy. And you talked about working with are doing research on non-Black students. I assume non-Black students at HBCUs, and also looking at all minority-serving institutions, looking at PBIs. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about this dichotomy that we impose on institutions, or the field of higher education, HBCU versus PWI. But it's more complex than that. So talk about that complexity and what that might mean for the future of HBCUs.
Yeah, no, I think that's a really good question. I think we're seeing, you know, more HBCUs more intentionally recruit non-Black students. And I think we're kind of seeing more non-Black students being attracted to HBCUs, primarily for three reasons. Number one, they realize that HBCUs have great affordable programs, the programs of certainly of quality. Number two, a lot of these institutions are in close proximity to the students' communities, right? And number three, you know, even though there was some in a presentation, there was some data that alluded to that HBCUs were a little bit more expensive. Research shows that non-Black students are on average attracted to HBCUs because they're actually less affordable. And so we kind of see a number of HBCUs becoming more racially and ethnically diversified, you know. And that has presented some challenges. For example, there was an article recently, I think in a Baltimore Sun, where there was an issue at Coppin State. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with the issue where Coppin State, they had elected a Latina homecoming queen. And there was, you know, some controversy. And actually, the folks in Inside Higher Ed reached out to me and I offered some commentary about that, you know, really talking about the ways in which, you know, as HBCUs work to recruit more non-Black students and more non-Black students enrolled in HBCUs, just working to make sure that HBCUs really protect their mission of serving Black students, but also create a community where all students feel embraced and want it and feel a sense of belonging. And I think that, you know, some HBCUs, I think faculty are doing that work, but I think there is some challenges, you know, if you will, among alumni, you know, and some current students who, you know, rightfully so feel like that, you know, the HBCU is their kind of sacred space to kind of get in contact with their community. And I think there's some some Black peers on campus see non-Black students, they kind of feel like, hey, you're invading my space. So I think that HBCUs have to be more intentional to, number one, create a more inclusive community for all students, but still kind of, you know, focus on preserving that tradition of supporting and serving Black students. And I think that's a delicate balance. And I think we need more research and more kind of practical examples as to, you know, how that can be done. But also I think that too, the HBCUs need to begin to have more conversations around diversity, you know. And diversity is not limited to this kind of binary that we know in terms of Black or white. It's also, you know, with throughout the diaspora, for example. You know, we as Black people are so diverse, you know, and we don't get a chance to kind of celebrate that and really get to know the within group differences among different Black students on campus. So I think that HBCUs have to play a better role in that process as well.
Yeah, those are some important observations. And you know, I think about the slide that Dr. Koch presented that showed the flagship white institutions, mm-hmm. and this very, very small percentage of Black students. And when you know, HBCUs get a lot of attention for having predominantly Black populations. But if you look at the diversity of HBCUs, we're actually more diverse than those flagship institutions. So it's the flagship institutions are really the ones that should be getting the scrutiny for not being diverse. So I think it's, you know, it's important the way that you have conceptualized that. But what do you think about, because a lot of people will ask, will more non-Black students coming to HBCUs affect the mission? And, you know, is this, I know it's not a Black and white thing, but is it a good thing or a bad thing when we start to increase our diversity in terms of having more non-Black students?
Yeah, you know, I think that's a conversation that folks in the literature are kind of still having this debate about in terms of, you know, how will to increase racial diversification, particularly among students, because we know that faculty at HBCUs are, you know, pretty much diverse. But, you know, how will that impact the mission of HBCUs? And I think we need to see more research, and I think we need to see more practical examples of HBCUs who are, you know, attracting more non-black students and still doing a good job of kind of serving black students. And right now, to some extent, that we're kind of seeing that play out, because we know that the vast majority of HBCUs, the population is still overwhelmingly black. But as we reach into the future, you know, and we see more non-black students enroll in HBCUs, I think we have to kind of be more intentional to see how will that impact the mission, and what HBCUs can do to make sure that the mission of serving black students stay at the forefront, while also still supporting non-black students. Because my contention is, if you're going to enroll non-black students, the institution has a responsibility to support these students and make sure that all students feel a sense of belonging. That really is important.
Very diplomatic answer. No one say it was a good thing or a bad thing. No, I know it's not that black and white, though. So
Ivory, can I chime in on that?
Oh yeah, yeah, go ahead.
So we actually interviewed the former president of West Virginia State, which is no longer a majority black HBCU, along with the other one in West Virginia, Bloomfield State.
Yeah.
And Tennessee State is really close to tipping in that
over
direction.
Yeah.
And he talked about how the non-black students at that university actually embrace sort of the culture of HBCU, because it's a mission-driven university, right? Which is the difference between an MSI or PBI. Like, those are, my friend calls it demographic accidents, right? It just happened to be a lot of black people in that area. So that's why it's a lot of black people at their school. Mm-hmm. But HBCUs, their mission is to help that category, right? And so you'll always have a difference when it's the mission of the university. And so he said that he really, it really wasn't the same effect that you would think. It's just, it's not as many black people in West Virginia anymore. And most people go to school really close to their home. Most people don't go out of state. And so that's the population that they can serve.
Right? All right. So do they embrace it like John Brown, or do they embrace it like the hipster in Shaw? All right, Dr. Koch.
I would add a little bit of empirical information here. Over the last 10 or 15 years, the percentage of non-black students at HBCUs has gone up, but it's not coming from white students. Mm-hmm. It's coming from Asian and Hispanic students.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, compelling conversation. Shift gears a little bit, because I want to ask Dr. McClendon about something that you said about communication with funders. Because, you know, one of the things about the Patterson Institute, a lot of the things that you all produce seem to be PSAs for HBCUs. And UNCF are also very robust funders, more so than a lot of HBCUs are. And a lot of times I do see some HBCU representatives in the space of funders, and sometimes they get a little too honest, right? They may say things, you know, like it might be a faculty member talking to a funder, talking about how many classes that they teach and how difficult it is for them to get a course reduction. So I want you to talk a little bit about the UNCF strategy in using data to get funding, and what can HBCUs learn from that?
So I think currently our approach in Patterson is really to collaborate with HBCUs. And so recently at ASH, the Association for the Study of Higher Education, we had a conversation where we invited HBCU presidents and higher leadership to be able to have conversations with funders and those who would be, deciding who gets the money for research, to hear from them what kind of collaboration they're looking for as the HBCU. So what some of the feedback was is that we're not looking for you to come to our institution and tell us what you want us to do and give us the money and then we do it. What we want is to be able to do the good work that we are already doing in collaboration with you, and that you will fund that based on the fact that, as you know, our PSAs may show, that they are doing good work and have already been far more innovative than a lot of the predominantly white institutions or historically white institutions in different areas, from aerospace engineering to agriculture to business education. And so since that is already proven, we also provide empirical feedback to back that up whenever it is needed, but also create opportunities for them to have face-to-face time whenever we can get the funders in the room, for them to be able to express that to them point blank, and then we support that however we can. So one example is in my work with the Student Freedom Initiative. They have this goal to help institutions through like cybersecurity, wraparound services and whatnot, but my approach to my role in that is to go to institutions and have conversations around what it is that they need from these people like Prudential, who are saying, we want to come in and have financial literacy courses for students. And I'm talking to students and they're saying, I don't have time for that. I don't have time for a 90-minute course two times and then a 12-month program that teaches me how to invest. I have issues right now. And so what I really appreciate in the book is like the findings around financial aid, financial literacy around FAFSA, and the real life issues that they're navigating at the time that they are students. And so that's one of the things that we've kind of used data that we've collected to then say to people with the funding, this is what they are asking for, this is what you should do. Don't bring any other ideas to the table unless they match up with what students are requesting and what faculty administrators at these schools are requesting based on the data that we collected. Because if you're going to be evidence-based, then you need to be lining up with that, with your money as well.
Yeah, thank you. Dr. Koch and Dr. Swenson, have there been any discussions about how to leverage the information in your book to help with HBCU funding?
So I've actually talked to what we presented at HBCU Week, I think last year, and I talked to NAFIO. I talked to Michael Lomax and Leslie Baskerville with NAFIO. And so our hope is that people who want to donate to these schools could see the evidence that these schools are doing good work. And it's not just saying that, oh, it's some secret sauce. It's actually good work where we could show you that, you know, if you're a black student, all else equal, if you go to HBCU, you're more likely to graduate, right? And if you're trying to improve the black wealth gap, students who go from HBCUs are more likely to have more income further down the road, right? These are kind of issues that people have concerns about, and we're trying to put data to it so that they can see if they get their money to HBCUs, hopefully they'll be able to help the university survive and to lead to these better outcomes.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So I have a question for you, Denise. So you talked about endowments, and I've always been interested in this mismatch between the endowments of HBCUs and other institutions. And just to give some numbers here, so in 2019, Harvard's endowment was $37 billion, and they posted an 8.1% return on that investment, which yielded $2.9 billion. Now, the annual operating cost of Fisk is $29 million. That means Harvard could fund the entire operational cost of 10 institutions the size of Fisk every year off of the endowment of their, off the interest off of their endowment. So my question to you is, do we need to try to help HBCUs to get more in their endowment, or is the endowment system just so effed up that we need to blow up that entire system? Because it is kind of controversial. I mean, it's not really framed as controversial, but there should be some discussion about giving to institutions that have so much endowment, just hoarding as a charitable act, as a tax-deductible charitable act. So what do you think about that?
No, I actually absolutely agree with that. I had the privilege of hearing Dr. Ruth Simmons give a commencement speech during 2021, where she had a call to action to Ivy League institutions to share their wealth and align with HBCUs to support these institutions because the endowment gap was so wide. It very much mirrors the racial wealth gap in this country. And I think that the system is rigged. Just from doing my research, I looked at institutions like Rust College, who have a $20 million endowment, but for some of these institutions to actually work with different investment industries or companies, they would have to invest $10 million just for them to be able to start to see return on investment. And a lot of HBCUs are not going to risk the lifeline of their institutions in a system like that. So to your point, it is rigged. Because if you come with less wealth, you're not willing to take the risk to invest to be able to grow your wealth. And so I think we have to really think about different strategies. And for me, the report was focusing on federal policy to help address the issue, but it is going to take a multi-pronged approach to address the endowment gap. It is going to take other institutions to figure out how they can align themselves with HBCUs to really support them, because they know that these institutions have actually benefited from black labor, right? And so the least that they can do is align themselves with institutions to support their growth because of that.
Yeah, good point. And I remember having a discussion with a Ivy League, a representative from an Ivy League institution. I won't say their names. But they had some money that they wanted to invest in HBCUs, and they kept, they was asking me about whether some of the needs at HBCUs, and how could they leverage this to address the needs? And a lot of the things that they were suggesting was about them helping the HBCU. And I was frank with them. I said, just give them the money. Now there are some organizations like UNCF that I think are positioned to help HBCUs in ways other than giving them money. But an Ivy League institution, what you have most that they need is the resources, not any expertise or anything like that.
I think you're spot on. I think the one thing that Mackenzie Scott did well with her gift giving was that she gave these institutions unrestricted dollars to allow them to figure out what they needed to do with the money. And a huge portion of those leaders actually put their money into the endowments because they knew about the benefits of having that endowment investment. They knew about the 4-5% drawdown that they could use for student scholarships or financial aid or dealing with infrastructure challenges or faculty salaries. So they knew the benefit of growing that endowment to see the returns grow so they could do better with their funding and supporting their institution.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Very few leaders of foundations attended an HBCU, and most of them are abysmally ignorant about what HBCUs are and do.
Yeah.
And I would go further than that and say I grew up in the North, hundreds of miles away from the nearest HBCU, and perhaps 60% of the American population knows nothing about an HBCU, and they're thousands of miles away. So the first task is to get these people informed, and yes, they should go out and buy our book and read it. There really needs to be almost a religious movement to convince these people that HBCUs have a function and is legitimate and they are successful, and that's why they deserve support, because these people don't know anything about HBCUs.
Yeah, good point. All right, so we're getting close to the point where we want to invite the audience into this, but before we do that, I just kind of want to go around and we've talked about a lot of different things, and I saw some people kind of doing that, a hopscotch, maybe want to say something. So I just want to go and I'll start with you, Dr. Palmer. Anything that you want to say before we open it up for discussion? Anything that you want to hit on?
Yeah, and I don't want to, go over this again, but, talking about endowments, which I think obviously is incredibly important, when you're robbing Peter just to pay Paul, and you get that, these resources, and you have other priorities, such as paying faculty, trying to find ways to support students, how can you encourage institutions that are barely, surviving or even thriving? And I want to be clear, not all HBCUs are like that. We have to be mindful that HBCUs are diverse. And I don't think as in a research community, we do a good job of at letting folks know that HBCUs are not monolithic. But even still, how can you be intentional of encouraging folks to think about endowment when they have other priorities, just trying to survive and keep their doors open?
That's a good point. Dr. McClendon.
I think the last few points around the endowments has been interesting to me over the last few years of seeing how people have used COVID dollars, because I would make the argument that HBCUs have made way better decisions in supporting their students and surrounding community with that money than any of the other institutions, possibly combined. I don't see them helping students to pay off debt so that they graduate with less debt with that money, or to make sure that communities have internet access instead of just the school. So I think what they do is create or use a holistic approach that has far-reaching implications. And I think that what we continue to want to share with others or to exemplify is that that kind of thought, forethought, is what makes the social mobility that they create so far-reaching, and why they can have this impact of moving students up in our report is from the bottom 40% to the top 60%. So not just those folks who make, you know, $100,000, but those folks who come from impoverished communities and become teachers and educators that made more money than their family had and impact their community as well. So a social return on investment, not just a return on investment that's monetary.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And I think one thing consistent about HBCUs, and you know, there's a lot that we say about HBCUs that may not be supported by data. But I think one thing that I've observed that I think is true: HBCUs do more with less. And sometimes I'll see HBCUs get large grants from the federal government, you know, from NSF or NIH, and they may have difficulty spending all the money. And it's not because they don't need the money; it's just that a lot of these research one institutions, their notion of what you spend money on is something that HBCUs really don't need that much money to spend on. They need that money for something else. And so it's almost like the HBCU has to negotiate with the National Science Foundation so they could reallocate this to things that they really need, you know, like maybe student support or something like that. You know, where we see, you know, like John Hopkins, you give them $2 million, they'll spend that so fast and you know, tell you that they need more. So we really could learn from HBCUs. You know, there are things that schools like John Hopkins can learn from HBCUs in terms of how to leverage your money more responsibly and how to use it on things that really matter. Ms. Smith.
I just want to say that I just appreciate the book holistically, just for being able to highlight the value proposition of HBCUs. I think there are so many times where I've had conversations with people, my friends on the accountability side of the world when it comes to higher ed, that want to focus on metrics. And I think it's important for us to be able to look at some of the recommendations in the book to really highlight how we can talk better about the value proposition and creating metrics and possibly policy recommendations that can actually help the Department of Education and our institutions get more funding because we do things differently in a way that they aren't necessarily capturing right now. And I also appreciate how in the book you talk about the land-grant universities and the challenges in funding from states, and also the challenges in board governance. And I think that people aren't really seeing a through line with what's happening right now. I mean, we look at Florida, for example, the students and alumni are currently suing the state for underfunding at Florida A&M University. But you also have to understand that they have a governing body that includes the governor, right? And so I think we have to think about the correlation and the connection between governing bodies and policy and funding, and how in some instances it might be stifling an institution versus actually helping it grow, and looking at how they might be helping predominantly white institutions across the state flourish.
Good. All right, so we're going to open it up for Q&A, and we'll have our authors take the first questions. So the first questions, if it could be about the book or for the authors, that would be appreciated. Then we'll open it up to everybody else. We're going to have about 30 minutes of Q&A. I know that this is a long panel, so if you need to stretch your legs, not all as a group, because we're not giving you a break. You don't have a formal break, but if you need an individual break, they also got some snacks out there, too. All right, so questions, and I also want to acknowledge those who are with us virtually. Hopefully there's someone monitoring the Q&A portion of the chat or in the virtual screen. So let's open it up. Who has any questions for the authors?
Given the change in nature of what we expect the demographics to be in a couple of years,
how valuable is your work still? Because if we're, if the demographics are changing and the country is becoming more people of color, and we're going to have all these schools competing for these students, is there a real need for us to maintain the designation of HBCUs if we're all competing for the same students?
So I'll answer that first question with the change in demographics. So the first thing is there's power in being white in America, like, and acknowledge that is like a lot of Hispanics identify as white, right? And yeah. If you look at what happens with first and second and third generation Hispanics, they become less and less likely to identify as Latino, mm-hmm. right? So long term, it's gonna be not that we'll be a country of majority, minorities. It's not gonna be that way because people identify with the power that they're white. But if you look at where blacks are in America, and where they could be and where they came from, HBCUs have been a vital part of that, right? And they have helped a lot of blacks get into a lot of successful positions. And so regardless of what happens to our society as a whole, I think it's important that these institutions still exist because black people in America do need to be have a place where they can go, where they feel supported, that helps them be more successful than other places. Right. If you look at what happened in California and Texas after they got rid of the affirmative action, black people essentially disappeared from the major institutions in those schools. Right. And you now have the Supreme Court order that might get rid of affirmative action total. What's going to happen at these institutions where they have who don't necessarily want black students there? Mm-hmm. Black students might not have anywhere to go in America if HBCUs don't exist. Right. Mm-hmm. Right. And so, you know, I think I don't want to see America without HBCUs. I went to Florida A&M, right? I'm a Rattler. And I wouldn't be the person I am if I wanted to went to Florida A&M because it was an environment where my teachers cared about me, they wanted to see me well, they supported me, and they helped me throughout. I still talk to my professors at my university now. And I don't know if students who go to non-HBCUs, black students, get that same type of environment. I went to graduate school at Duke. And I would talk to the black undergraduates who were at Duke. And they didn't have that same feeling of support, like they belonged at the institution, that they deserved to be there, that other students had. And you can say the same thing about wealth and institutions with students who aren't as wealthy, go to wealthy institutions, a lot of people are wealthy, and they don't feel like they belong as well. But if you're black, you can't hide, right? Like if you're a poor white student, you can kind of fit in and no one knows. But if you're a black student at those types of institutions, it's noticeable that you're there. And whether you belong there or not, when people see you, they're going to think, well, you're only here because the school needed another black person, right? And so I think that HBCUs are important even as changing demographics because of the benefits that they're still conveying to the higher education system.
Yeah, that's a good point. And you spoke to this a little bit too, Dr. Palmer, so I want you to also respond. But it's important to keep in mind that this is a historic designation. So HBCUs will always exist. You would literally have to erase history, which there are some people trying to do with the anti-critical race theory movement. But that historic designation will be there just like Catholic University is historically a Catholic university, but they accept, you know, all types of religions. I think, yeah, they do. So the history is the most important part, but it does connect to what Dr. Palmer talked about earlier, you know, in terms of letting the mission, be what the institution is about, not necessarily just the demographics, because the demographics are changing. But what does this mission mean to not just African Americans, but the LGBTQI population? You know, like how do we take that mission and evolve it to the times, as opposed to setting ourselves up to not be relevant because we're not looking at our history and our mission, but we're too focused on the changing demographics?
Yeah, you know, I think we see the demographics changing, but we also see, you know, we've seen recently that more black students are obviously choosing HBCUs in part because of the current political climate and the racist climate, the racialized climate that we still find ourselves in. And we know that, you know, for decades now, that black students at predominantly white institutions, even though that term may be problematic to use, some folks use historically white institutions, whatever the case may be, those black students at, you know, I'm gonna use the term PWIs, predominantly white institutions, still face problems in terms of racism, racial microaggressions, kind of fighting racial battle fatigue, this kind of racial toxic environment. And that's true for black faculty, and that's true for minoritized students. And so I still think, you know, even though we see this kind of change in landscape in terms of demographics where the majority, it's the minorities become the majority, we still have issues with race. And those issues are played out carefully and very strongly at predominantly white institutions, you know, and that really is provoking more black students to choose HBCUs and possibly other minority-serving institutions. And quite frankly, I don't think as much as we provide information to PWIs to kind of help them improve the climate, quite frankly, I don't see anything changing. You know, I think, you know, there are certain folks on those campuses who don't want to support black students and who don't want them there. So I, you know, there's so much information out there in terms of the way in which institutions can use, PWIs can use information to make the environment more inclusive. But do those institutions actually want to use that information to improve the climate? Or do they want to find excuses? And I actually think they want to find excuses. And therefore, you know, HBCUs will be very much relevant. You know, the one thing we do have to be mindful of is that given historical designation in terms of HBCU was an institution that was classified as an institution that was founded before 1964, I believe, or 65. Once an HBCU closed, that institution would not be, you know, reopened. So we do have to be mindful to make sure that we do not allow any more of our institutions, HBCUs, to close, because once that institution is gone, with few exceptions, obviously we see the rebirth of Morris Brown, which has kind of, been kind of fascinating, you know, due to tracks. So I'm actually working on some research around that. But, you know, we have to be mindful to really protect our institutions to provide and preserve access and to support for black students. That's important.
Yeah, Dr. Cope.
I wanted to offer a slightly different picture, and it's somewhat parochial since I'm talking about my own institution, Old Dominion. You saw the slide that shows Old Dominion's black enrollment going up and Norfolk State's going down. The fact is students are voting with their feet. And some of the black students, not all, but some of them are finding this particular majority-minority institution, which is what Old Dominion is, and it's 25,000 students, 8,000 or 9,000 are black. Some black students are finding that a congenial atmosphere. Now, I'm not trying to sugarcoat anything in terms of problems that might be there and the like, but the president is black, the provost is black, the chief financial officer is black, and the student body may turn out to be majority black in a few years as well. So I think if you look at, let's say, Old Dominion, Virginia Commonwealth, Georgia State, there are a lot of large urban institutions that are doing things sufficiently different that students, again, are voting with their feet.
Yeah, and a lot of those same institutions, you know, like a Georgia State, at first they were looking at University of Georgia as their competition. And then they decided, oh, well, maybe, you know, we got this big black population in Atlanta. Maybe it's Clark, Morehouse, and Spelman. Maybe that's our competition. So we do see a lot of University of Memphis. So a lot of these institutions, regional state universities, are these institutions that was in the shadow of the flagship institution. And they're looking at these demographic changes that you know, we're seeing. And they see this as an opportunity to fill in their gap. So, you know, it's something that we definitely need to study more.
Can I add something?
Sure.
I think going back to the original question of like, what will the role be of HBCUs as things continue to change, that we sometimes assume that it's only the role that they play on for enrolled students, right, on campus. But we've been doing this report around workforce development of alumni, talking to alumni at HBCUs, and really hearing that it's this ongoing sustained network that lasts 20, 30 years out from that experience. So it's not just while they're on campus in comparison to PWIs, it's you get what you get when you're there. When you leave, nobody even answers your calls. And we're seeing, in addition to that extended sustained network, it bridges out to students who never went to HBCU. So black students who are welcomed by an HBCU graduate that's a peer, and they say, this is how you navigate this space, or I'm in this space, this is what you need to do in this interview or for this job. So then you create networks from mentors, peer mentors who went to HBCUs, and bring other black folks into that network. And it becomes a bigger network that has a more impact than PWI networks ever will. Mm-hmm. And so I think that even if the enrollment shrinks, that role is going to continue to become more important, where more students and more people will be looking for that kind of community and will be looking for that kind of camaraderie. And I don't think it's been replicated anywhere else.
That's a very good point. As we think about the value of higher education, it's not so much what you learn, because, we're all using the same textbooks, basically. It's about the brand, and it's about the network that transpires after you leave. And it is powerful, it's something that's happening organically, but I don't think we really think about and operationalize it. But it's powerful to graduate from a collective brand. So a lot of people hadn't heard of Jarvis Christian College, but they have heard of an HBCU. You take Jarvis Christian College by itself, they come to Washington, D.C., and they say, I graduated from Jarvis Christian College. Most people would be like, what's that? But if you say it's an HBCU, I get it. So you have this unified experience. So I think that is something that we need to think about more often. Other questions?
Good evening. Thank you very much. I'm panelists and authors as well. And I would like to direct this question. First of all, I'm Elijah Bratton, second year PhD student here at Howard University in the Higher Education Leadership and Policy Studies program. And there are so many things I appreciated about this book. I brought it with me and everything, right? This was a fantastic read. And one part that I found particularly intriguing, I would love for you to unpack a little bit more about governing boards. And this is something that, we don't hear as much about when we are talking about universities and their own survival. But you reference this particular research that suggested that HBCU governing boards were very, very business heavy, and that this could be a potential reason for high turnover rates and presidencies at HBCUs and along those lines. And I really wanted to hear your thoughts a little bit more about whether you believe that there need to be more educational professionals on boards, whether you agree with his assessment, or if there's further analysis that you would like to offer to what you suggested in the book.
My experience with board members who come from the business community is frequently they think they can transfer nearly all of the techniques from the business community to the academic community, and that's simply not so. Oftentimes they have difficult adjusting. They're also used to, for example, being able to get rid of employees immediately, and the whole notion of tenure is just foreign to them. So it's a very different kind of circumstance, and so I think some of them are not as well suited to a board membership as they think they might be. I think, though, also in the case of HBCUs, frequently we have governing boards that are overly intrusive. They interfere too much, and as a consequence, you get lots of executive turnover, a little bit more so according to the data than you see at the majority institutions. And part of that is a function of who the governor appoints, and in many of the public HBCUs, that's where the rubber meets the road. You have to get the governor to appoint the right kinds of people, and they need to be people who are interested in HBCUs and understand their mission, or at least can be educated, and frequently that's not the case. And so, you know, you read in the newspaper like this recent upheaval at Jackson State, that's just not helpful. It's something that is disruptive to education and is not good advertising. And I've written another book on essentially governing boards and educating and training governing boards after these people have been appointed. However that happens is really critical, because many of these people just don't understand what universities do.
Dr. Tolson, I have another question, and maybe it's really a question, not so much a question, but an inquiry as to do your book talk about an effort of university systems to overtake HBCUs? I'm a graduate of South Carolina State, and under Nikki Haley's reign as governor, there was a strong effort to sort of subsume South Carolina State under the university system. And so I'm wondering, does your book address that issue? Because from me, it appeared that it was a way to sort of minimize the presence of HBCUs.
Yeah, I think there is an instinctive feeling by some white politicians, white elected officials, who don't think there is any longer a need for HBCUs. And so they look at HBCU and they'll say, why can't that be merged into this or that? And it's a circumstance that largely reflects what it is that they don't know and what they don't understand. And if you look at this in a more national context, again, I know this is a very, very prominent HBCU. It's the flagship. But most people out there don't know very much about HBCUs. And I grew up in the North, and I was certainly like that. I know more now, but I can't claim I know everything. But there are lots of people in the U.S. Congress in very important positions who just are ignorant. And they, the same thing oftentimes is true for board members. They get appointed by a governor, and they just don't have an understanding of what it is that HBCUs have done historically and why they are needed now.
And just to add to that, if you look at what the state of North Carolina did in North Carolina A&T, punishing them for having too many out-of-state students attend university, or if you look at the lawsuits that are won in Maryland and Tennessee against the underfunded HBCU, historically, the governing bodies have treated HBCUs differently. Like, Florida A&M has like third-tier status in the state of Florida as a university, which means that they can give us less funding because we're a third-tier institution, right? And that was what happened when I was there, when they changed the way the schools were ranked so they could fund the schools less, right? And so these kind of things are still happening today in society. And the people who are appointed to each state's higher education board really determine what goes on in those public schools. And there's always these kind of tensions between HBCUs and the state governments, for the most part. Virginia is probably one of the better states in terms of funding their HBCUs. Maryland is doing much better now if you look at the new construction in Maryland. But that's because they lost a lawsuit, right? And so, you know, without being forced by some other entity to do it, most of the southern states don't take care of HBCUs the way they should.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think the larger point here is that the states don't have to take over or subsume a HBCU within the system for that overreach to happen. You know, it's happening without that. And I think there's a lot that could be learned from Maryland, from the lawsuits. You know, to be quite honest, there are some HBCUs that have been subsumed within a system, and it's not that much different. You know, like Grambling was subsumed within the University of Louisiana system, but it's still Grambling. You know, there might be an argument to be made that some of the students have more resources because they can go outside for, you know, some of the classes that Grambling doesn't have and all that kind of stuff. But the state overreach is always going to be an issue. So that's an issue if they subsume it within a larger system, or is it an issue when it doesn't. Yeah, the mic is for the virtual participants.
Okay, good afternoon. Good evening. I am Eddie Gray. I'm a third-year doctoral student in the Department of Economics here. I am a Rattler as well. And I also grew up in Nashville, around Tennessee State and Fisk and Meharry and all that good stuff. So my question is related to the U.S. the graph that you had with USC and South Carolina State. In your data or in your analysis of the data, did you find that there are more states that are actually using appropriations or misappropriations of the different funds to subsidize and to create that competition? Because I'm referring specifically to what's going on in Tennessee right now with the 50-year misappropriation of the land grant funds and moving that money from Tennessee State to the University of Tennessee system. And they did it for 50 years. And now that part of that money's starting to come back, the state has, this was like 2 weeks ago, they're creating ad hoc committees within the state Senate to try to change the governance of the university. So I was just wondering if this is something that you have seen, or if there's a pattern that, hey, we're gonna use these appropriations to subsidize, to make this lower, so that we can maybe drive these folks out of business as opposed to just trying to take them over altogether.
Well, I would say, truthfully, that pretty much the opposite is occurring. As Amari indicated, in most states in the former Confederacy, the HBCUs are getting more money per student than the comparable white institutions. That's true in Virginia, it's true in Maryland, and most of the other states. The farther south you go, generally, the less true that is. But the task facing an HBCU doesn't completely depend upon state appropriations, because the students are coming in with very different financial backgrounds, and so we need to talk about financial aid and Pell Grants and a lot of other things. And that's why when I showed you that graph comparing, for example, South Carolina State and the University of South Carolina, that's after all the grants and so forth are taken into consideration, and HBCUs are being underpriced. Now, is that deliberate? Well, I sort of asked the question, do these people even know that that's occurring, that the University of South Carolina is underpricing South Carolina State, and Grambling is underpricing, or is being underpriced by a very nearby Louisiana Tech. So on the surface, if you look at state appropriations, there doesn't seem to be a problem. It's only when you look at net price and see, well, what price are people actually paying? There is where you see the problem. And that reflects a lot of other factors other than appropriations.
And just to follow up on that, the weird thing about state appropriation rules are they can have rules, but they don't have to follow them if the governor says we're not going to follow the appropriation rules, right? So I have a paper that looks at how HBCUs, for the most part, are underfunded in general, and then underfunded during recessions. And I talked to every state higher education system, and they said, yeah, we have a formula, but in the end, the governor decides how the appropriations are going to be applied to each institution, regardless of the form.
Other questions? All right, right there. And are there questions online? I don't want to neglect. Okay.
Hello. My question, or I have some commentary before my question, but within the last decade, college students expressed their day-to-day lives on social media. Institutional communications teams can try to track it down and dispel this information, but sometimes their experiences are just that. A poor experience with dining, financial aid, housing, a particular faculty member, etc., gets blasted. Also, ignorance, specifically within the Black community, affects the way HBCUs are viewed. And so, with all of that said, how do we bridge the gap between students' lived experiences in modern day times and research, whether qualitative or quantitative, to positively showcase our HBCUs?
Denise, you have anything for that? Since you're younger.
I mean, I personally think that, you know, it's important for us to be able to educate young people about what's happening on the campus. I think for me, it's been more about how do we help young people understand what are some of the challenges that are happening on campus, whether it be the housing crisis that we saw play out last year, but also understanding the context behind a lot of these issues. And the fact that, like, yes, like, this is an issue, but your institution is also underfunded, and there is also an external entity that manages this property, not necessarily a university. So, like, providing additional context to things, I think, is also important in how you talk about a particular issue. But I also think that it's important for us to be able to arm young people with information so that they can be advocates for the institutions as well. I have a number of young people that have just been able to learn about the funding challenges and inequities around HBCUs, but also then knowing about their own personal experiences and how it's been contributing to their personal and professional life, that they have become advocates for their institutions as well. And so I think we have to also empower students to also be advocates within themselves to be able to advocate for change.
I was going to add, you know, in 2018, a colleague and myself, we interviewed over 80 black students at four HBCUs. We were trying to understand our college choice, particularly in terms of Donald Trump. And one of the things we learned in terms of that study was these students actually use social media to get a sense of, you know, what's going on campus and, you know, what was a campus experience. And so that was for those students who were looking to apply to colleges, particularly HBCUs. They looked at YouTube and, you know, Instagram and Facebook. And so, but interestingly, you know, while there may be some stories that do not portray HBCUs in, you know, in a positive light, given the fact that there are some, you know, issues around funding, there are some good stories on, you know, social media, for example, you know, where you have folks talking about their experience living in the residence halls, you know, or their experiences of interacting with the faculty. So really encouraging institutions to kind of tap into those resources and better use social media, and having HBCU leaders create accounts on social media, you know, YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, and so forth and so on. Given that many students now make their first kind of get their first impression of the campus experience of the HBCU using social media. And also, one of the things I do like, you have a number of HBCU presidents who are actually using social media, primarily Facebook and Twitter, to kind of really tell their own story and really kind of toot their own horn about the great work that's going on our campuses. And so continue to encourage more HBCU leaders to use that platform, knowing that, you know, again, a lot of students are using those resources to get their first impression of the HBCU and to decide if they're going to enroll or apply to HBCUs.
I think I would add briefly that maybe they can embrace the fact that they are cultivating students who are really active in civic engagement, and that they have had a historical legacy of creating activists, civically engaged students that understand and can understand all of the competing kind of commitments that the school is really engaged in, what's going on under the surface, political motivations, and really become critically minded but civically engaged to make changes on campus that maybe they need to be the one to bring it to the surface. But I don't think that's inherently negative.
Sure.
First of all, I'd like to thank the authors and the panel for bringing us this valuable information based in data. I'm a Howard employee. I have two children who are Howard alums, and I'm a second generation HBCU graduate from Tougaloo, Mississippi. I find it, for me, what's very concerning is the enrollment data, not so much for the large state-funded HBCUs or for Howard, for instance, who's having a tsunami of applications, but for the smaller private HBCUs. I find enrollment very concerning. Some of it may have to do with leadership, but I think that most of it has to do with the realities of the day. So I'd like to ask the authors, through your research, and I like the data approach versus the anecdotal, you know, approach. Being from Tougaloo, they're having some serious enrollment challenges, you know, right now. And I tell my fellow alums in the local Tougaloo Alumni Club when they say, oh, that president is, well, tell us about the enrollment. It's going, I said, it's going down nationally. I said, he says, but not at some, I say, Howard and FAMU, they are outliers for this, you know, for this thing. The data that you mentioned about high school graduation going down, coming from a state like Mississippi, this is all very concerning. So does your data, or is there a way we can look at the data and find some hopeful ways to stem the tide of some very serious enrollment declines in the smaller private HBCUs? Thank you.
Yeah, so I'll answer that question. First, I lived in Mississippi for a while, so I know a lot of people graduated from Tougaloo, and Tougaloo has some great programs, like their partnership with the doctors who go to Boston and get, I know maybe four or five people who I went to high school with who are doctors because of a program that Tougaloo had, right? And I think a lot of it comes down to the leadership of institutions. Institutions change as their presidents change. You know, my dad was the president of Benedict College in South Carolina, and he grew the college when he was president from a relatively small private HBCU to the largest private school in South Carolina, right? And it has to do with the recruitment and going out on the road. If you look at how small FAMU used to be and how large FAMU is now, it's because of Dr. Humphreys. Dr. Humphreys went around the country and recruited the best black students to go to the institution. Right, every HBCU faces different challenges. I think the way that for the smaller HBCUs is try to find a steady state where we could find enough students and have enough funding so that we could survive. Right, there's a lot of small colleges in the US that don't have many students, but they have their budget where it works, where they don't need more students to survive. Right, and that has to do with long-term planning and a lot of forethought and good leadership and governance for those institutions.
Yeah, there's a few, you know, and the panel has talked about this, you know, you have the narrative and then you have the reality. And, you know, there's this narrative that all HBCUs have this booming enrollment when, as you all pointed out, it's specific HBCUs. But I look at a school like Tougaloo, and I know that, you know, the Google isn't always accurate, but just Googling Tougaloo acceptance rate, it's saying 56%. So that means, you know, we have to reconcile Tougaloo having this decline in enrollment and rejecting 44% of the students that apply at the same time. And a lot of these students are being scooped up by community colleges and God forbid, for-profit institutions. So one of those narratives versus reality that we have to reconcile is HBCUs aren't as accommodating to all of these students, you know, particularly the students that we consider unprepared, as we might be stating. And some of these students may be an opportunity for HBCUs. You know, some of these students who need the remedial courses, who, you know, they barely got out of high school, or they may not on the surface seem like they're gonna be, you know, they're prepared for the institution. But what might we be able to change at our institutions to better accommodate this 44% that we're rejecting? So I think that's one of the things that we have to think about too.
I just want to add a point to that.
And you have to come to the mic. I'm sorry.
For the virtual audience.
Yeah, they can't hear you.
Okay. I quickly want to add a point to that. I used to work in higher ed finance, and the acceptance rate is largely tied to credit rating as well, like for your ability to go out to the the bond market and do things. Like, if you're not I want to say exclusive, then, or you're accepting everybody, then they'll think you're a weaker bet in the bond market. So that might be part of why a lot of folks say, okay, we need to have a cutoff at some point. But
yeah, that's good information to have. And that's the kind of conversation, you know, that's a nuance and a detail that we need to have when we have these kinds of discussions. Yeah. Because you know, on the surface, we're just thinking, oh, less students are interested in HBCUs. But when you dig deep into it, you know, it may be something else. Maybe bond ratings. You know, it may be, you know, U.S. News and World Report rankings. You know, there's all these incentives. And you know, we have these universities that we put on the pedestal. You know, the ones that's at the top of U.S. News and World Report. They are the most selective, meaning they reject the most students. They are the most expensive. So, you know, if we're modeling after these institutions, then we can pick up some practices that's not in the best interest of our own community.
How you doing today? I just like to say that maybe it's me because I went to a HBCU, but we don't advertise. I didn't grow up here in DC. I was born in DC, but I grew up in Virginia. So I knew about three HBCUs, Howard, the other HU, and of course Norfolk State, because those are only three schools that I knew about. We don't advertise at all. I've traveled this country doing shows and events everywhere. I see more H's when I travel than I see M's for Michigan, but it doesn't make sense that the only H I see is for Howard.
Yeah.
So part of it is we need to go out and in our communities, our schools need to go out and let the people in the communities know that we are here.
Yeah.
Let them know that what we offer. Because if we don't do that, we're still sitting there in the box and no one pays any attention to us.
Yeah. That's a good point. That's a good point. So we're at time. No, you done talked twice already. That's one of them. All right, go ahead. Say it in the microphone. Say it in the microphone for the audience.
Dr. Palmer talked about this idea of schools looking at LGBTQ people. Mm-hmm. But my thing is, we're missing an opportunity as well when we talk about students with disabilities.
Mm-hmm.
Students with disabilities are increasingly going to college. Mm-hmm. HBCUs could take advantage of that and increase their population by looking at that population of students, because there are students who have disabilities who can learn and do great things, but we don't think about that.
Yeah,
and it speaks to looking at our mission and reevaluating our missions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Dr. Palmer said that. You didn't hear him? No, he said disability. You didn't hear him? Everybody else heard him, right? Y'all heard him?
I heard him say LGBT.
Y'all heard him? Look, see, nodding, right? Yep, nodding his foot. All right, thank you all. All right, so I'm going to turn it back over to our fearless leader, Dr. Carter, but let's give our panel a round of applause. Thank you all so much for your information.
Also, let's give our moderator, Dr. Tolson, a hand. I mean, he's absolutely, wonderful in terms of his questions and his thoughtful dialogue interaction with each panelist. So again, thank you so much, Dr. Tolson. You know, this was a great session. I want to thank Dr. Koch and Dr. Swinton for this wonderful work. We could spend hours, I'm sure, talking about the insight that's shared in this book. I think I've read it two or three times, and I have so many pages earmarked that I think I do Audible now. That's my thing, okay? So I'm like, someone needs to read, okay? This needs to be on Audible, because I need to read it, hear it coming to work, leaving work, and et cetera. But it's so powerful because I think, I mean, of all the data points, there's so many that really gave me great pause. Because I think it really helps us to reconsider what we think we know about HBCUs. And the one data point around graduation rates I mean, certainly many of you know me, I've labored in the area of student success here at Howard for some time, and this issue of graduation rates and trying to certainly prove, in fact, what we already know, that we're doing great work in graduating students. But these data prove that, I mean, document it, provide evidence that, in fact, when you take into consideration SAT scores and family income, that, in fact, we are graduating students at higher levels than some of our other, than PWIs, which is an amazing statistic, which really turns the current conversation on its head in some extremely important ways. That data point alone moves the conversation from a deficit model to an asset model. So I really appreciate the great work that is contained herein and look forward to continue to rely upon it for great information. And again, I want to thank the panelists. I know if there is a tracker on the Frederick Patterson website, I'm there about 15,000 times because certainly their impact reports and all the great work that they do are critical resources for those who study HBCUs or are concerned or interested in sort of conveying the great work that we do. And certainly Dr. Palmer, who is my chair, and his great work in HBCUs, we appreciate it. And Denise, Ms. Smith, who's worked with the Century Foundation and also as a student in our program, but certainly her deep knowledge of the policy implications of this conversation certainly were revealed. And so we certainly appreciate all of the work that you're doing. So again, thank you so much for coming. We had a robust virtual audience as well as an audience in person. We really appreciate you coming out for this session and your support of the HBCU Center. And we certainly welcome you to invite you to visit our website, look out for other programs and be involved in the work that we're doing. So thank you so much. We have refreshments. We want you to enjoy those, but have a good evening.